Good evening. I'd like to welcome you to the school board budget workshop. We have an agenda this evening, a little bit changed from what we thought we were going to have last Saturday. We are going to be receiving a presentation on facilities, maintenance, capital improvements, things like that. We think it probably will go 15, 20 minutes. If there are any individuals who just think that they would prefer to just make a statement, ask their questions before that, we will allow some time for public comment. Otherwise, we request that we can take the majority of our comments and questions after the presentation. After public comments, the school board will then go into deliberation. So on that note, I'm going to open up for public comments for those who just can't wait for about 15 or 20 minutes. In the interest of giving, there's a lot of people here this evening. It's a phenomenal turnout. It's quite a contrast to our public forum last year. So in the interest of giving everybody a chance to speak, we'd like to request that you keep your comments to about two to three minutes this evening. That way we'll have time to actually deliberate, hopefully. So I'll open up. Okay. Okay. I'll lean in. Sorry. I do not. Okay. We are going to entertain some public comments now for those who think that they can't wait 15 or 20 minutes, because we are going to be having a presentation on facilities, maintenance, and capital improvements that did not get covered last Saturday. After that presentation, we will open it up again for public comment or questions, and then following that, the board will go into deliberations. So for those individuals who feel they absolutely need to make their comments or questions now, I welcome you to the podium. Okay, great. Let's go right into the facilities presentation.
Pauline, do you have materials to pass out, and Ernie's going to speak to it, is that correct?
Yes, I didn't make copies of the CIP. It's in your,
okay.
Right. In your budget book.
Right. I'd also like to let everybody know that there are some copies of handouts that we had at last Saturday's meeting for those of you who weren't here.
Good evening.
Ernie, would you introduce yourself to them?
Yes, my name is Ernie McVane, Facilities Manager for the town of Cape Elizabeth. And I've been asked tonight to go over my capital improvement plan for all three schools.
Ernie, you're going to have to speak up just a little. The people up back can't hear you.
Okay. Is this all there is for a microphone? That's the one. That's it, huh? Gonna have to talk to maintenance about this one, huh?
Glad that you are.
Not in the budget.
Okay, I'll try to do better. This year's budget, the two budgets combined, basically middle school Pond Cove and the high school, is about $18,500 less than it has been in previous years. The reason for that is a lot of items were taken care of through both the renovation of the kindergarten wing, or the new kindergarten wing, and the renovation of the high school. So I believe you have the spreadsheets in your handouts there that break down the different projects that we propose to continue on with this year. This is similar to past years in that each year we try to improve a certain number of classrooms at the high school. By improve, What we've been doing is replace the ceilings, the lights, upgrade the electrical, flooring if needed, and so on. Some of that, or most of that money's been removed from this budget because at the end of this year's project, we pretty much completed all the rooms in the high school. So it, with the exception, I think there's three or four rooms left. There are funds available in this to complete those rooms this coming summer. We try to do five rooms a year. That's been our goal. We've been averaging four. Sometimes we will get to the fifth room, but not every year. But this year, we've already got a jump on some of these remaining rooms, the teacher's lounge, the book room. As you know, we're doing some work outside the project in the library. We're building the circulation desk, which was taken out of the project because of a significant cost. We've also been able to upgrade all our unit ventilators in the high school and so on and so forth. Currently, we're putting in a new generator at the high school, complements of Homeland Security, which will make a significant difference for us when we're without power. The larger items that through the whole process have concerned everyone is my request to install a second hot water heater at the middle school complex. The reason being is the existing water heater, they're telling me, service techs, that it's on its last legs and it may go another year, may go another 5 years, it may quit tomorrow. My concern was that should this unit fail, and that's in my budget, that's a $28,000 item. The bids were at, to put that in, came in around $40,000. My intent is to purchase that directly and have it installed and be the general contractor on it, not go through anyone else. So that's $28,000, and that is a decision that the board has to make, whether we continue on that in that route or not. That's the larger item, really. It's the $28,000 for the hot water heater. I'm not sure there's any substantial project that I'm proposing to do. There are a lot of little projects throughout the facility, but nothing major at the high school due to the renovation. I'd be glad to answer any questions anyone might have with regard to this proposal. Pauline, did you want me to does the board want me to comment on contracted services, or are we just doing CIP?
Okay.
Is that a yes? You want to do that, yes.
I can. It's okay. Contracted services is the actual cost that what our cost is to run the various services throughout the year. And if you go to page 4, this is the contracted services, and this is actually going to be about what you're going to see every year, except for the cost of inflation. It tells you how we break the money down. We have emission fees. We have air quality monitoring. That's money that we carry so that if there are some concerns about, there always are concerns that, you know, someone gets sick or something, and it automatically becomes an air quality problem in the minds of the person that's sick. And we go right in there with our people and have it tested, and we waste no time on that. And we've been our air quality has been excellent. We haven't had any problems whatsoever in any of our schools that I can recall for some time now. Then we have a number of certificates and licenses, and and inspection fees for elevators, boilers. As you can see, we spend several thousand dollars a year just for HVAC air filters. We have a fire extinguisher program where we bring somebody in yearly to test and re-inspect our fire extinguishers and all our Ansel systems that are used in our kitchens. And then we have a maintenance account for boilers, and that's for all three schools. We carry a little money for preventative roof maintenance. Our sprinkler inspections, again, that's not a lot of money, but we inspect all our facilities quarterly. One thing that you'll see a slight increase here is waste removal. It's getting to the point where it's costing us more to remove stuff than it is to purchase it. At the end of the year, we have to collect all the unused waste materials or the waste materials that are generated throughout the year. Usually, as soon as something they're finished with a certain chemistry experiment or whatever the case may be, that product will come to maintenance, we'll store it, we have containers for it, and then once a year or even twice a year, I'll bring an outside company to come in and remove those waste. Miscellaneous is exactly that, batteries, plumbing, window repair, et cetera. So it's pretty, you know, it's pretty forward, straightforward. Then if you go into the end of the chart, you can see that what our oil consumption is versus our cost. Although we're going to be over this year, our estimated gallons show that we've done better than we may have had the weather been a lot colder. That's about all I have to report to you. If there's any questions about any of this, I'd be glad to answer it for you.
Thank you, Ernie. Elaine?
The savings on the water heater at the middle school, you mentioned something along the line that it was going to cost $28,000, and it's in the budget. Requested at 45, and then 9,600 was cut for a revised budget of 36.
Correct.
Are you still working your magic with the salespeople, or what?
Well, no. To purchase the heater itself, just the unit, was $18,000, and the estimate to install just the unit was in the neighborhood of $10,000. The remaining 9,600, whatever it is, is what we generally carry every year in that maintenance account. I have to carry monies in the maintenance account. If we lose a burner motor or something like that, I have to have the till to draw from to repair it. So if you look across over the years, you'll see that we carry anywhere from $8,000 to $10,000 in the Pond Cove Middle School maintenance accounts, in the mechanical accounts. It says upgrades here, and that's basically what it is, replacement of motors. In a high school, we carry slightly more. Somewhere in the neighborhood of $10,000. I will say that the last couple of years, vandalism has gone way down at our facilities. We still have some, and you still read about it now and then, but when you start adding up the dollars, it's no comparison to what it used to be 6-7 years ago. And we attribute a lot of that to interacting with our students and security cameras. So.
Can you talk a little bit about the pool ventilation and any type of changes that are occurring there as far as budget impact?
There's no impact on the school budget from the work that's currently taking place for the pool facility. The only we share two utilities. We share heating and we share electricity with the high school. And Pauline can correct me on these numbers, but we budget on the town side, and we have a We have a sub-meter that calculates our electric use, somewhere in the neighborhood of $60,000, which, when we take that money and transfer it to the school side, we base it on actual usage off this sub-meter, so that we're paying, that the town is paying for the use of that, not the school department. The other issue is fuel, and Pauline and I have come up with an estimate of what we use. Basically, it's a tank through the summer months, and I think this year it's $9,000 or $10,000. I'm not sure just what the monies are, but it's a representation of what we actually use throughout the year. So I can't think of anything that the school would be picking up on in terms of the use of that facility. There were some questions about ventilation systems, and we do share the ventilation system for the locker rooms with the school ventilation system. I mean, it's two locker rooms, and it's in scope of things, and it's really not that significant. The main heating system and ductwork and everything for the pool and the humidity control for the pool is a separate unit installed in the pool up on the second deck, up over the offices of the pool area.
Kathy? Ernie, when you last spoke with the Finance Committee, I think you were mentioning that you were in the process of balancing the high school system, heating system.
Correct.
Can you comment on where that stands?
From what I've been told, there's only two or three contractors in the state of Maine that actually do this, and to get anyone to make a commitment has been very difficult. So the service that was provided as a result of all our construction and new ductwork, all that system's been balanced. The original high school, the main classroom exhaust vents haven't been. The fresh air intakes for all the classroom, all the modulating valves were replaced from pneumatic to electronic, and that has helped a lot. But we still are looking at trying to find someone that's willing to come in there and do that, and do it sooner than later. But it's been very difficult for us to get anyone that will do that. And we've talked with, well, I know of three companies.
The cost of that balancing is coming out of the high school bond?
Correct. There has been money that's been earmarked for that. I believe it was $5,000. And it's still available, and hopefully we can resolve this and get it done.
Based on some of the information that we've heard over the past couple weeks, I'm just curious, are you comfortable with your roof and window repair numbers that we see in here? Because that's where you've done some cutting, and questioning what your comfort level is there.
We're close to the life expectancy of the roof, of the typical roof in our system is 20 years. I mean, that's when the warranties and everything terminate. We still have some issues at the Pond Cove School, the middle school, where they haven't been able to locate the leaks. We've had a number of vendors come in and look at it, different vendors over time. You know, we've given one person a shot at the door. They just can't figure out, well, we have to try someone else. And right now, I think one of the areas my crew did find the leak, and we fixed it. It was a roof drain, but that was down in the library of the Pond Cove area. But we still have some leaks, and we're working to find them. What we are doing is we try to remove the ceiling tiles as quickly as we can, because like every facilities manager, our biggest concern is that we don't allow these things to stick around because of mold and things that are associated with it, so we get them right out. But, you know, there's always, you can always find a stain tile here and there, but it's getting better.
So you're saying that the situation is more a reflection of just a difficulty in tracing the leak versus the money available in your budget to address?
At this point in time, next year and the next few years after, we'll probably be looking at the possibility of getting a bond to start doing some other areas of the roofs that have been around since the renovation of the middle school, which was, what, 80, 80, 94? Time flies. I don't remember. It's about, what, 12 years now, I think, since, yeah, 94, 95.
I have a question for Pauline regarding the bus lease included in the equipment. We are still looking to replace one bus with a lease, and the budget cut that you show there in order to accomplish that is a reflection of a lower cost from the state retroactive based on what we thought we were going to pay for a bus?
It's a lower cost from going out to bid on a new bus. We received a lower bid than what I estimated.
Estimated, okay.
Is there any questions for Ernie? Thank you, Ernie.
So, thank you.
I have a question. If they decide not to replace the heater at the middle school, is the kitchen still going to be able to function without it? And is there money in the contingency plan that you would then be able to purchase a new heater?
I'm not a betting man. But I can tell you right now, if that heater went next week, we'd be ordering a new one. The problem isn't, I mean, they'd have to find the money somewhere, okay? They're going to have to find it because you just don't run a school without hot water. The issue and the way I, you know, I approached the finance committee was it's going to take us anywhere from 4 to 6 weeks to get this piece of equipment. They make it per request and not something you pick up off the shelf. It's a 300 to 400 gallon tank with a large burner and recovery rate of so many gallons a minute, and they just don't have them in stock. So that's really the concern. And we've talked about different ways of going about it, and I think this is probably the best approach, is to purchase the tank ourselves and then hire someone to put it in. And we were able to trim it down from like $42,000 or $43,000 to the $28,000. Okay? And to answer the question, as far as the kitchen has its own hot water boosters for their dishwashers and stuff, but their general sinks and washdowns are contingent on us providing hot water from our boiler rooms. Yes.
Okay, thank you, Ernie.
All set.
Okay. I just want to remind you that there should be at least one pad of paper, if not several, circulating that we would love to have you just sign in so we can know who was in attendance here this evening. And we are now going to open up to public comments and questions. And again, I respectfully ask that you try to keep your comments or questions to 2 to 3 minutes so we can allow all of you the opportunity to speak and still have some time for deliberations. So with that, I open up the floor. Oh, and please state your name and address.
My name is Maura Nichols. I'm a 16-year resident of CAPE, a parent of a 7th and a 9th grader. I'm also an educational technician at Pond Cove. And I'm ashamed, I'm embarrassed, that while this is the third school board meeting I've attended in a week, it's probably been 9 years since I last showed up. I have never been to a town council meeting. So I congratulate myself for voting in every election and then sit back and hope that because I've done my civic duty, the elected officials will take care of the rest. And herein lies the problem. Sometimes, as voters, you get lucky. You elect board and council members who work with extreme dedication to meet the needs of the whole town. Sometimes, however, you find you've hired individuals who look good on paper, but who seek the post to further their own agendas or that of their small constituencies. I know it sounds just like Washington, or even Augusta, places where those of us of a certain age know that outrage gets you nowhere. It is impossible for the average citizen to affect an outcome in those arenas. But it is possible here. We need to show up, speak up, and pay attention. Yes, property taxes are high, and in some cases, arguably, unfair. But a cap of any kind is not the answer. Under the 3.4% spending cap at my property value, I'm due for a whopping $15.82 reduction next year. The cost of that 15 bucks is that the schools will be decimated and our children's education will be severely compromised. My concern is where the revenues generated and the monies in the so-called general fund in this town are being allocated. My concern is for the quality of life in Cape Elizabeth, and that means, on the most fundamental level, the quality of the school system. We get the government we deserve. I, for one, am done being a passive citizen. It is time to turn the silent majority into the vocal majority. Thank you.
Okay. Next person, and may I ask to limit applause, please, just so we can get people up.
Hi, I'm Cindy Garfield of Abaco Drive. Thank you for the opportunity to address you, board and superintendent. I support the superintendent's recommended budget with an increase of 7.7% and urge the school board to put this version forward to the council, not the 3.5% survivor's budget. You've done an exemplary job in being able to put together two budgets, and I saw your pain on Saturday as you recognized the shortfalls that we would have in critical areas that impact the quality of education. While the 3.4% cap does meet the objective of the council, it does not meet the objectives of our other stakeholders, namely the students, our talented school staff, and the taxpayers. The council wanted to, where did this 3.4% come from anyway? The council wanted to link that to the consumer price index inflation rate. Well, as of January 2006, the consumer price index, as reported by the Bureau of Labor Statistics, is actually 4%. It's gone up and it's been driven by an increase in energy costs, which you've also experienced here. I will try to go fast because I know that I've only got about a minute left. The 3.5% also reminds us of that Pulaski tax cap referendum, which we voted against by a margin of 70%. Now, in the larger picture, by trade, I am a budget analyst, and I do it in the private sector and have for 20 years. I'm also a 20-year resident of Cape Elizabeth. If you look at the overall picture of the school budget, we talked about increased enrollment. Well, that increased enrollment has come with increased taxpayers. We've had several new subdivisions built in this town in the past 5 years. Just in the past year, Leighton Farms was completed. With those 38 new students came tax-paying parents in newly constructed homes. The valuation of our town has increased by $12 million year over year, bringing in an additional tax revenue of $141,000. Additionally, the state funding for education, essential programs and services funding, is projected to increase by $488,000. The school funding formula is based on enrollment. One of the factors is enrollment. So the state has determined that because our enrollment has gone up, we should get additional essential program and service funding in our schools. Why would the council earmark that for something else? I just cannot understand that. So on the revenue side, our revenue is going up by $632,000 next year. The voters have the choice of where that goes. That's an increase in 3.6% on the revenue side. Just because the school budget goes up 7.7% doesn't mean our taxes will go up 7.7%. With the revenue going up 3.3% and the spending on the schools going up 7.7%, the increase to our tax rate would be only 52 cents per mil, or 4.8%, which would be an additional $130 per household based on the median house price. And I agree with the previous speaker that that's a small cost for what we'd be giving up. Thank you.
In order to expedite this, I would like to suggest that if there are people who'd like to speak, that if we can maybe start a queue so we don't have to wait for everybody to stand up and make their way. So.
Hello, my name is Nick Daly of Tides Edge Road. Good evening. My name is Nick Daly, and I'm the junior class treasurer. Just sitting through the budget meetings on Saturday makes me realize how complicated the process of coming up with a budget that meets both the needs of the students and teachers while making sure that the taxpayers of Cape Elizabeth are happy is not an easy one. Thank you to the school board for your continued work in this area and for allowing this process to be an open one. Having an open forum where all citizens can be educated as well as have their voices heard is extremely important, especially to the students. After Natasha and I listened to Saturday's meeting, we held a full SAC meeting at the high school to let the SAC members know what was going on. Many had questions about cuts and future cuts. Hopefully, you will start to hear some of the concerns from our student body. From me personally, I am concerned about the possibility of the high school schedule consisting of 7 periods instead of the 8 today. It is already hard to take electives with the current schedule. As Mrs. Stressinger pointed out Saturday, if I wanted to take more electives in the science or math area, this would almost be impossible. It is already difficult, as many science and math classes are only offered on odd years at best. Mr. Hawkins and school board members, I urge you to put forward a budget that you feel meets the needs of the students, not one that reflects an unrealistic cap. Thank you.
Hi, my name's Natasha Barrett, and along with Nick, I'm a town council representative from the high school. A goal I set for myself a long time ago was to get published before I graduated high school. Most would probably think this is nearly impossible and certainly unrealistic, and prior to taking the creative writing class up at the high school, I probably would have agreed with you. But this class has provided me with the opportunity to do this. For this reason, I was particularly shocked when I heard the town council was even considering cutting creative writing. There's no question it is a challenging class with a fairly intense workload. However, I can guarantee you that the students enrolled are extremely excited to go to class and eager to share their work every day. We write around 3 to 4 pages every night, working on various writing techniques, becoming more experienced and well-rounded in the process. It is easily the most worthwhile thing I've been a part of this year. There's no overlap with respect to the curriculum taught in normal English class, and if this class was taken away, there would be only one English elective left in the high school. The goal at the end of this class is to have a polished portfolio with several pieces ready for submission to publication companies. Without this class, my goals, as well as those of my peers, might never be realized.
I'm sorry, excuse me. I need to respectfully ask that we hold applause this evening. There's just a lot of us here, and we really need to get through. I know you're all very passionate and excited about this, but
we can just hold. And I won't take it personally if you
don't. And I'm sorry to cut it off at you.
No, that's quite all right. My name is Paul Edmond. I hadn't intended to speak tonight, but there are several points that I'd like to make. First of all, nobody likes taxes. We know that. But everybody who says they don't like taxes also wants some benefit that is paid for from those taxes. Because what we seem to forget in our society on all levels is taxes are an investment. We invest in snowplows, in sewers, police protection, fire protection. We should at least invest in our children's education and our future. And that is what we are discussing here. If we expect to have an educated populace, and if we expect to have a town that has a school system that it is proud of, then we have to invest in it. And that's really what it comes down to. Now, I am a parent. I have two children, fourth and seventh grade. I also obviously pay taxes. I also have another perspective as well. That's not for me, I hope. I have another perspective as well. I've had careers in science and law. About 7 years ago, I went into teaching. I am dual certified and qualified, not the same thing. I teach at Scarborough High School. I've taught physics and geoscience. I'm teaching the AP classes. I have a background in law, as I mentioned, and so forth. I don't want to see happen in Cape Elizabeth what is happening in Scarborough. Is this cable going into Scarborough, by the way? Anyway, I don't want to see what we're going through down there. I teach the AP classes. The AP classes are hitting 30. We are short of supplies. If we want requisitions, we have to go to the principal, who goes to the superintendent. We have a bright, shiny building and virtually no support for what goes on inside of it. You can quantify those things. You can talk about numbers, 3.7% caps, 4.0. It doesn't make a difference. You can quantify those, but what you cannot do is talk about the qualitative impact that those cuts have. It's debilitating. When you have to fight for supplies, when you have to fight for support, when you have to fight for the most basic things that you need in the classroom, there's going to be an impact on students, on teachers, the school system, on parents, and a whole range of things that don't lend itself to input into a spreadsheet. You don't want to have happen in Cape Elizabeth. I don't want to have happen in Cape Elizabeth what is happening in Scarborough and in many other places around this country. So, forget these arbitrary caps. Realize that if you don't invest, you don't get a return. And if you don't invest in our kids' education, it will reflect. It was sort of off the cuff, but thank you.
Thank you.
It's on a point.
My name is Nancy Marshall. I've lived in Cape Elizabeth for 9 months. I didn't expect to speak tonight either, but I'm a grandparent of students in the schools, and communities that do not support their educational programs, salaries for teachers, supplies, equipment, they shortchange themselves in the long run. And there aren't many white-haired people in the audience tonight, but I'm here to say that both my husband and I support you submitting a budget that reflects the needs that you see it and not try to maintain a 3.4 increase just because the town council told you you should do that. Thanks. Thank
you. Good evening. My name is Kathy Perkins, and I did not intend on speaking tonight. Somehow being in this building just makes me want to do that. But anyway, I figured I had a good audience to let people know. I've been involved in the budget process in the past, and I'm hoping that everybody who is here tonight, plus anybody else you can drag, will be in the same building next Monday night at 7:30 at the town council's meeting. As we all know, ultimately the town council gives the allowance for what the school is able to spend. So, and certainly they have their reasons for doing what they do, but it's really important that we're all here, like I said, and everybody bring a friend next Monday night. The other thing that I wanted to just put forth is that in the past when I've been to budget meetings, the town council has finance subcommittee meetings also that can be attended by the public. And those meetings are public. I think that Paul McKenney is the chairman of the finance subcommittee meeting. And I think kind of the nuts and bolts of putting together a budget, you know, I don't know everything about it, but really happen at those finance subcommittee meetings. When I've attended them in the past, I've just a wealth of knowledge has come from them. So anybody that can attend those, that would be really good, and I'm sure that there are people in this audience that would be more than happy to make those times and dates available. And like I said, the school board can use all the support they can get. Boy, I wouldn't, you know, we appreciate everything that you do. But if we could all make it here Tuesday night, pardon me, Monday night at 7:30, that would be awesome. And like I said, make sure you bring a friend. So thanks for hearing me.
Bye. Thank you.
My name's Sue Pierce. I live on Hunts Point Road. And I'm asking the school board not to pass a budget that meets a 3.4% spending cap. I think there's a lot of confusion over this cap. I know I was confused. There's been a lot of talk about, do we need a vote to repeal it? I was told just yesterday by Mike McGovern that there is not a spending cap, that there was not a directive of 3.4% increase, but rather an understanding that this would be a target for a spending increase. While I applaud the efforts to try to put forth a budget that meets this understanding, as school board members, I feel that it's your responsibility to approve a budget that reflects our school's needs. As are many people in this room, I'm concerned about our teachers, their salaries, their benefits, our ability to keep the excellent teachers we have, and also to attract new teachers. I'm concerned about the old textbooks, larger classroom size, meeting federal and state mandates, increased enrollment cost, rising energy cost, and the rising special education cost. I can't help but say, as being on building committees for 6 years, I'm also concerned about the facilities. When I hear that there's a garbage can to collect the rain in the middle of Pond Cove, I wonder if in another 10 years we'll be facing the same issue that we faced in 1993 with the middle school, and just these past 3 years with the high school, when people ask, how did we get here? So I hope that you will support a budget that is good for our schools.
Thank you. Is there anyone else this evening? Don't be shy.
Hi, my name is Debbie Cushing, and I wasn't going to speak tonight, but nobody's really said that I think most people in this room are here because they don't want to see a 3.4% spending cap. If there's anybody in this room that's here to support a 3.4% spending cap, I hope you come forward. But I want the school board to feel empowered by all the people that are here that we support. If you can have the courage to vote a budget that you think is the right thing for our kids, that we will be behind you, that you have parents and citizens behind you, no matter what you want to do, and I hope that you can unanimously come to an agreement, that there's no division among you, that it will look so much better to the town council if you can come together and do this unanimously. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Kim Sturgeon. I play many roles. I've been the guidance counselor at the middle school, and part of my role is accepting new families, and they come in, and I interview them about the needs and why are they coming to Cape Elizabeth. The number one thing I hear is they're coming for the schools. They come and they compare themselves. They're shopping. They shop between Yarmouth, Falmouth, Cumberland, and Cape. This isn't looking good on our resume. So I don't think the 3.4% spending cap is what we need if we want quality education. Also in December, there was a survey that was done in Cape Elizabeth. I don't know how many of you were part of that. It was a phone survey. I think 303 people were surveyed. If you look at the results of that, which is on our town website, it was 54 pages long. I pulled three of them out. As you can see, I hate speaking in public. The perceived importance of our Cape Elizabeth benefits just below the natural beauty of the place is the importance of our schools. We have a wonderful school system, and that's what people want from this community. Also, the perceived importance of our goals in the town, just below, again, preserving our woodlands and our the beauty of the oceans, is the schools, again, just under the beauty of the town. Also, the level of support for intended purposes, increased taxes, just under the biking trails, are the schools. Again, it's about beauty and it's about schools. That's what Cape Elizabeth is about. That's why I moved here 6 years ago. and I come here with my children. Schools are important to Cape, and if we want that to continue, the 3.4% cap is not going to get that for us. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anybody else this evening? Okay. Oh, sorry.
I already made a statement, but I forgot I had a question at the bottom. I didn't get to it. It's a question for Mr. Shedd, and that is, if this survivor budget is passed, what's the risk that the high school will lose accreditation?
I don't know. I suppose that there is a risk. Where our accreditation is right now is that the accrediting team came in. They visited our high school. They've issued a report that goes to the New England Association of Schools and Colleges Commission. Those are the people who decide whether we our accreditation gets continued. I can tell you that there were some things that were in the report that commended Cape Elizabeth High School, some of which are going to be affected by the cuts in spending, and one of them is the common planning time for teachers because of the loss of study hall monitors. And there is one more that was significant, and I'm blanking out on it right now to tell you the truth. But that one in particular is one that that we've been commended for, and now we're eliminating. And the process at the New England Association of Schools and Colleges is whenever there's a what's called a substantive change in a school system that can either positively or negatively impact the perception of the school system by the association, I am required as the principal to report that. Now, I won't be reporting that until after the commission actually takes a vote on our accreditation. So I don't want to overstate and suggest that we are not going to be accredited because of what's going on through this budget process. I can only tell you that I will have to report as principal one or two changes as a result of this, depending on what happens under the commission rules. And could that conceivably affect accreditation? I think it would be a stretch right now for me to stand up and say that there's a significant risk, but I can tell you that there are things that will happen that will that I will have to report that because they will negatively affect the schools.
Thank you. Yep.
Thank you, Polly.
I thought that was very helpful.
Actually, the major one really was the support for individual, for professional development for teachers. Across the board, across the district, I hope this is okay that I'm answering these questions. Is that all right? No? It's up to you.
For myself personally, I don't have a problem with it.
It's a workshop, so to speak, that I would support allowing this to happen.
Okay. We just want to be...
as soon sit down.
Yeah. I just want to be sure that none of our administrators are put on the spot in a way that makes them uncomfortable or... Okay.
No, I'm trying to be fair to it. The other one that we have been significantly commended for in a number of places in the report that the commission will be considering this spring is in the area of support for professional development. And if the current budget goes through, it's a fact that our professional development will be cut by about a third, not just for the high school, but for the other schools as well. And I think that's one that I would have to report as well to the commission.
So it's a risk.
There's some risk. I can't quantify it for you, but yes, there is some risk. It's information that needs to be reported.
Thank you.
Yep.
And I believe actually some people have just arrived, so I just want to make sure that they know this is the chance to make comments, statements, or ask questions.
I guess I'm supposed to say that I didn't intend on speaking tonight. My name is Connor Hankinson. I'm the senior class vice president, and I've been the rep to the school board for 2 years now. And I guess as a student, you'd expect me to say that I oppose the plan because of some class that I really like or electives, which is true, but the thing that I'm most worried about, and I think a lot of students are most worried about, are actually the teachers. I went to Wayne Fleet for middle school, which is a school that I think is kind of known for having really good teachers. And after eighth grade, I came back to Cape because of the teachers, actually. I have now a really great relationship with a lot of, especially my English teachers, and they've helped me a lot with, you know, things about like writing college essays, and I think that that's something that's not necessarily really unique to Cape, but it's a very strong point at Cape that we have a really good relationship with our teachers. And I don't really know a whole lot about the plan, so I don't really know like how it would affect them, but I know that I wouldn't want it anything negative to happen to the teachers.
Good evening. My name is Mark Bacchio on Mitchell Road. And my wife, Trudy, and I have been here for about 9 years. We have a daughter in second grade, and we have two more that are going to be coming up through very soon. And I know that Trudy and I both show up and vote in the elections. We vote for the school board. And we're not experts on education. We rely on the school board to choose a superintendent who is an expert in education and an expert on budgeting and what our children need to succeed in life. And that you've done a good job in picking Mr. Hawkins, and that we would hope that you would go with Mr. Hawkins' recommended budget. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm not that uncomfortable speaking in public, but I wasn't planning on speaking because I thought a lot of people would speak. But since they're not, I'm going to speak. We've lived here 6 years. We moved from Pittsford, New York. We had a superb school system there, and we moved here for the schools. Now I'm going to say something you're always going to remember. I'm older than I look. My hair is gray, and I dye it. Okay, I'll tell you that too. Polly Wilcox. And my husband has gray hair, and I don't know if he's out there because I don't have my glasses on. Are you here, Steve? There he is with his gray hair. Okay. We are older parents. We love our kids and their friends dearly. In 2 years, when our son Jim goes to college, we could start saying we don't care about the schools, but we put a lot of money into our house here that we built here, and we wanted to live here. My husband's been coming here since the 40s. We both grew up in New England. This is where we wanted to live. And the property values are going to go down if you don't take care of the kids in the school. So forget about whether or not you care about the kids. The property values. You know why I'm saying this? Because the bottom line is, for some of the people who may not care to vote for the schools, is they will care about their property values, which is mean, but I'm going to say it. I am so thankful to have you, Mr. Hawkins, and I think you guys are great. I told Ann Belden today, and I've told her many times, you could shoot me before I would ever be on the school board.
Hi, my name is Heather Furman, and I'm sort of vice president and president of the junior class. And the reason I became part of the student council on sophomore year is because I really think that it's important for the students to advocate for themselves in terms of all the school decisions that are made affecting them. So I figured I should say something. And I guess the two things that I moved here when I was in fifth grade, so that was 7 years ago or so, and I'd like to echo what everyone else is saying, that our family moved here based on the schools. And the two things that really would bother me about this budget decrease is, first of all, the student-to-teacher ratio. I really, really admire the teachers in our school, and I find that the student-teacher relationship is really strong and really important to the students in our school. And that as long as I've been a student in Cape Elizabeth, I've never been turned down to be met with after school or during study halls or before school. And I think that's really important that the teachers about the teacher's salary and their benefits and things like that, and also with increasing student-teacher ratios that we might not have that opportunity as much as we might have used to. And also the idea with the schedule and the electives. As it is, you can only take something like 7 full-year classes, and with the required health and required phys ed freshman and sophomore year and the requirements of the tech and fine arts, it leaves you maybe 3 half-year classes to sort of delve into what you want to take. And if you're already taking band, I found that even as it is right now, I've really liked to delve into some things that I'm more interested in instead of taking, you know, just first level art. If I really wanted to get into that, I would have had to give up a study hall, and that's something I really can't do. So losing classes would be completely detrimental, and I think that it would really lose the student's opportunity to sort of take responsibility for their own interest and their own learning. So,
thank you.
Hi, I'm Anthony Kosner, Reef Road. We moved here within the past year. The quality of the schools was a very large part of the move. My wife did research on every single northeastern state and walked into my office one day and said, Cape Elizabeth, Maine, just south of Portland. And I said, okay. It took a little while, but that happened. The school district we had been in previously was a great example of what happens when a community does not support their school board. This town could not pass a school budget during the entire 12 years that we lived there. What had been a well-regarded school district when we moved there became a very, very mediocre school district. And there weren't even good private schools, so I mean it was not a good situation. I think that no one wants to go into a budget and say, you know, here's a blank check, whatever. You know, taxpayers don't like it. In the current environment, economic volatility is increasing, energy costs are going to increase, all of these things people feel in their households, they feel in their businesses, we feel in government. When it comes to education, it's not a business. You can't, you know, there are a lot of businesses that people have discovered, with half as many people, we can still make the same widgets with more technology or various things. You can't do that in education. Having the people have enough time to pay attention to the students is the most important thing. More important than computers. I mean, good to have computers, better to have teachers. Better to have teachers who have enough time to pay attention to their students. If there are cuts that have to be made, you know, there are a lot of smart people in this room. There are a lot of smart people in this town. There probably are solutions to the textbook problem. There probably are electronic versions of textbooks that can be printed out every year fresh, as opposed to investing in something that's going to, you know, be out of date. You know, should the town invest in renewable energy for the schools? That will cut energy costs over time. Maybe a good idea. There probably are smart ideas that all of us could come up with that could help cut costs, but it shouldn't come out of the human part. It shouldn't come out of the time part, because that's what's going to come out of the kids. Thanks.
Thank you. Okay.
Hi, my name is Bob Furman. I live on High Bluff Road. Almost every person who's spoken tonight has spoken about choosing Cape Elizabeth as a place to live because of the schools. And what's mostly been unsaid is that, and I too have chosen Cape Elizabeth because of the schools. We all paid a premium on our house to choose Cape Elizabeth because of the schools. And if we let our school system deteriorate, that premium goes away, and future buyers will not choose Cape Elizabeth because of the schools. Please keep that in mind. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anyone else this evening?
Hi, my name's Jenna Sisselman, and I live on Ledgewood Lane. I'm not going to quote any statistics tonight. That's been done and well said. But as I was sitting here, I couldn't help but notice the mission, vision, and belief of our Cape Elizabeth school system. And I know that you all can read, but I think it's ironic as we sit here and talk about what's going to be cut and how desperate our situation could be if we go with this bare-bones budget. I just wanted to point out two things. That the number one sentence is, for our vision, the Cape Elizabeth schools will be one of the top public school systems in the U.S. And then when you go down to the students and learning, that all students, their talents and their abilities are worthy of being recognized and developed. And down to the teachers, that they need time for collaboration, reflection, and professional development. And then when you get down to our community, that it's a shared responsibility among students, teachers, staff, parents, and the community. I'm sure a lot of time and effort and thought went into creating this mission, vision, and belief for our school system. And yet it's ironic that we just can't come up with the funds from our town council to support this. And I'd just like to urge you to go for broke. I mean, I know that sounds funny, but I mean, they're going to negotiate, and there's going to be give and take, and there's going to be a lot of shuffling. So I would just encourage you to not go with the survivor budget and know that we're all supporting you in that. Thank you. Thank you.
Anyone else?
Well, I'm Ingrid Stressinger, and like a lot of people here, I hadn't planned to speak tonight, but if you've been at the last couple of workshops, you'll see I'm not afraid to speak. And it's interesting that Jenna was thinking the same thing I was about this vision and mission statement, and I would just add to that that when we did this, I think it was about 6 years ago, I think it's important to note that it wasn't just teachers and school staff and administrators who were involved in this. There were many people from all parts of the community, including citizens and business people, and there was a long process that was gone through, and this is what we came up with. So it's not just the school working in isolation with the staff and the school, but the town as a whole, and I think that's really important that, you know, there's been a whole range of groups of people who've said that they really support this. My other concern is that if we are to allow this 3.4 budget to go forward, it sends a message to the council that, you know, we can live with this. And I really fear that while this budget does injury to the schools this year, that a following year with another 3.4 cap or whatever the price index is at that time will really cripple our schools, because the things that are painful to cut now will no longer be there to cut, and we have to go deeper. So I think it's really important, and I urge you to take a stand and support whatever budget we need to meet the needs of the schools. And I really ask that all of you come Monday night to the town council, and let's show the council that we are not the minority, that we are the majority of voters in the town, and that we did not vote for a spending cap, and ask them to please reconsider and repeal this understanding that they have amongst themselves. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Julie Salikas. I'm the school nurse in the middle school. I have been a parent. My children have both gone through the Cape schools, and I'm now almost a senior citizen. I started to prepare some thoughts tonight and then decided I wasn't going to speak, and then I changed my mind. So they're sort of prepared because I get a little nervous in front of you. It's actually much easier to be in your son or daughter's fifth and sixth grade classes talking to them about their changing bodies. I have worked here so long as a school nurse and a health educator that I'm now seeing the children of the students I taught when I first came here to Cape Elizabeth. Needless to say, like many of our other senior citizen colleagues, I've seen a lot of changes over the years. I also live in town, obviously. I think I've seen a lot of boards struggle with the budget over the years, and I have great respect for the work you people have done on the budget this year. And after listening to Alan Hawkins speak last week about the proposed budget, I can only beg of you to listen to what he has said and to what so many others have said. Because the one constant for me in the 30-plus years I've been here is to look out at a classroom full of children, and that never changes, the love and the caring that you have for the kids. And to see how that might change or be impacted by the budget is really devastating for all of us, not just us seniors, but the new teachers and faculty as well. Thank you.
Hi, Chris Lynch, Shore Road, and I tried all these meetings not to come up and speak, and I can't help myself. And I just had a question for the school board, because I was here a few years ago, and we were talking about the school renovations at the kindergarten and the high school. And how many of you were on the school board then? Two. And Julie really reminded me when she made her comment is that was the last time there was a group like this assembled, at least that I was part of and I knew of. And I was shocked that we actually got to that point. And it was very interesting to me at the time that the school board needed about $10 million. Maybe it was seven, maybe it was eight, maybe it was nine, but it wasn't three. And I came to the meeting where the school board presented its budget and asked for $3 million. And I was shocked. I said, why would they ask for three when they need seven, eight, nine, or 10? And since then, seven of the nine members of the board have been voted off, which I'm happy to see. And this could be, and there's a chance to do it again. If again, it has to go to referendum, in that case, it went to referendum as opposed to approving the $3 million to build the new kindergarten wing, is we have a similar situation today that the board has turned over almost 100%, it's whatever, 80% turnover, and largely because the school board didn't ask the school board for what they should have asked for in the first place, which was enough money to fix the schools at the time. And the school board didn't, and the town council didn't even support that decision on a $3 million budget ask to do the kindergartens at the time, and so it had to go to referendum. The town voted overwhelmingly in favor. It was very clear that the town supports the schools. I came in a little late, and I had to park down by Jonesy, so obviously there's about 200 people here, and I couldn't help but notice as I was walking across behind all these cars is the stickers on the back of the cars, Harvard, Yale, Stanford, MIT, Dartmouth, Duke, Princeton, UMaine, Bates, Bowdoin, Colby. I mean, clearly, it's a town that really does believe in its school system, and there's a bunch of very well-educated people here, and we'd all like our kids to be equally well-educated and have the opportunities in the future, and it comes down to some investment that's more than 3.5% a year, and it's that simple, and I'd encourage everybody to support that, especially the school board. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Tara Piasewski. I live on Kettle Cove Road here in Cape Elizabeth. I moved to Cape Elizabeth a year ago, actually a year and a half ago, and I was walking on the beach the day before my interview to be hired at Cape Elizabeth, the last teacher who was hired at Cape Elizabeth. And I feel really blessed to be hired because prior to this, I was working in Fairfax County, Virginia, which was the number five school district in the nation. And I felt very qualified when I walked in the door. And I feel more qualified now because of the colleagues that I work with, the support that I have amongst the teachers who are there, and the support from the parents in the community, and also from you. And I think cutting back on things like professional development are going to take away my opportunity to why not go for a doctorate, or why not keep going and get another master's, because it's just going to further educate myself and the children in my classroom. And I just want you to hear that, because the things that are being taken away are sort of the bargaining points of what's different between being in Portland. Yes, I was in a trailer in Portland, but I had graduate classes being paid for me. Or little things that go back and forth. So the quality teachers that you have here are very, 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 very professional. And if they could just stand up and see how many teachers are here amongst how many parents are here in the community, it would make a big difference, too, to say thank you to all of you who came tonight. Thanks.
My name is Amy Kieran. I am one of the kindergarten teachers at Pond Cove. I know Tom is probably wiggling in his seat right now, because usually I say something pretty silly and goofy and a little crazy, but I'm actually glad that Tara came up to speak about the professional development, because I wasn't sure in the past few meetings if it's been really clear what it means to teachers at our schools and what it means to... Like Tara, I came from another school district that I had worked at for 3 years in a not such a happy community. All right, one of the happiest days of my life was the first teacher day here 8 years ago when I started, which was in the cafeteria, and it's all of the high school staff and all of the Pond Cove staff and all of the middle school staff, and it was one of the happiest days of my life, because it is such a positive place to be. I mean, you think with school starting, all the teachers are going to be like, ah, summer's over, but, such a positive atmosphere, and I thought, this is where I want to be if they'll keep me, if I'm allowed to stay for the next, 50 years, because it's just such a, I want it forever to be that day where everyone was so excited that school was going to start and we were all going to get to do our jobs again and teach the kids and have such a great life. And along what Tara said, it's what professional development means to us is, I don't understand all the big budget stuff because I'm in kindergarten land, but what I do know right now is that I cannot take, I know I'm probably going to talk forever, but I can't, like Tara said, take a course and get reimbursed for it. So if I have a child with autism coming into my classroom, I can't sign up for a course and know that I will be reimbursed for that course. At this point, I know that I'm going to shell out $1,000. I'm probably going to put on my Visa, and then it's going to cost me, with my budget, my personal budget problems, that course is going to cost me like $15,000 by the end of my life. So, so anyway, my point being is that, to continue that happy atmosphere, to know that I can grow when I want and do and choose the courses that I want and learn as much as I possibly can about teaching these children, that's what professional development means to me.
Hi, I'm Susan Dana, another one also hadn't, I did plan to talk, but I thought everyone was looking for the big picture, but since we're on professional development, I brought up some specifics. My children also went through the Cape school system, K through 12. They had a wonderful education. I'm a resident here in town. This is my 16th year teaching at Cape Middle School. And just talking, I think I was probably one of the last ones that was granted a sabbatical, and I know the board would love to be able to grant sabbaticals, but I think your hands are just tied with budget. And I also would like to say that I really appreciate all the work that you put into budget, and not budget, but just being on the school board, because I know you're volunteers. I'm paid to be here. It's my job. But so I really appreciate all the time and effort and all these meetings that you come to. But I was granted a sabbatical for a semester in September of 2003, and I went to Spain. I was only there for a couple weeks, but the focus of my research was traditional games. And if any students, I see some students here, and they're probably tired of hearing about traditional games, but that semester did so much to invigorate me and excite me, and I definitely brought that back into the classroom. So professional development really energizes the teachers. I saw that the town valued me as a professional because you were giving me time to go pursue activities and interests that I have. In the bottom, always in the back of my mind, and I remember the sabbatical, the board members that interviewed me for the sabbatical, the bottom line is, how is this going to benefit the children of Cape Elizabeth? And I always kept that in mind on my sabbatical. My siblings would call and say, oh, it must be nice you're not going to school or whatever, but I had a very structured time during the sabbatical. But one result of the sabbatical is I had time to write proposals to present, and I did present at an international conference in Acapulco, Mexico in 2004. It was funded in part by the Cape Elizabeth School Department, in part by a grant from CEEF, and in part by a grant from the Foreign Language Association of Maine. Those opportunities, I think, I see them eroding. We might not have those opportunities. But as a result of having that time, I presented in Acapulco. And then the next year, I was asked to present at Yale University. And at that point, a few people come up, oh, you're from Cape Elizabeth. I mean, the name is getting out there. So it benefits not only the students, it benefited me personally, but it benefits the town of Cape Elizabeth. And then as a result of the Yale one, I've been asked to present in Massachusetts. I'm going to be presenting this Friday at the Foreign Language Association of Maine. And those opportunities really mean a lot to me, and I can bring those experiences back to the classroom. But I just want to write a few, the evaluation, this is from the International Conference in Mexico, and just the multitude of comments that I had. And I'm just kind of going to go through random, but just from Arkansas, I'd love to have a FLESS program in my district just like yours, and I may contact you regarding data that might encourage my district to consider the implementation of a program. From Pennsylvania, this was great, by far the most useful session. She teaches grades 3-6. Great ideas. This is from another one from Arkansas. Utah, University of Southern Utah. There are quite a few college professors. This is normally a conference for professors. Excellent presentation. I also like to contact you about a program in our school. So it just went on and on. Colorado, Illinois, Vermont. Very positive feedback. So this gets Cape Elizabeth out there. We're out of the state. So, and that's just one little facet that I see. If we're losing the professional development time, it's just we're kind of eroding at that foundation. We have a very strong foundation, but I see chipping away little by little at that foundation if we don't continue to support the schools. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm Jana Zimmerman, and you have probably heard from me more than you want. I'm at 81 Oakhurst Road, but I wanted to give you an update on the Zimmerman family situation. Being from Dallas, I appreciated the comment about shopping, because I am a shopping woman, and I shopped for the school district. And I disregarded the MEA scores because they're not a good predictor of college performance. So I was only interested in my child, and I was thinking, it's not going to affect her. And I didn't ask some pertinent questions that I should have. And so, as a Dallas woman, in my frame of mind, I started shopping again and talking to my family, my daughter. Should we be thinking about Yarmouth, Cumberland, the places we passed up before, Falmouth? We researched them all, but should we be there for your sake? And my child said, well, she understands the whole concept of underfunded budget. And deficiencies in schools that an adequate school system, not to mention a premier school system, would not have. So I didn't even have to explain all that to her. But she explained something to me. There are excellent teachers at Pine Cove. She's a Pine Cover. And so for the kids that are moving, if any kids move, it'll be good for them because they'll be in a good school system. But it'll be bad for them because they won't have Pine Cove teachers. So, I really support the teachers, definitely. And I'm not shopping, I'm waiting. And I wanted to let you know that Ann Swift Cayetta already emailed me, because I'm technologically illiterate. When I was in school, like Polly, perhaps, I'm coloring my hair and the computers filled an entire room. I wouldn't have known that as an education major at the time, but I had an engineering boyfriend who's now my spouse. And so I would go in and, you know, enter his cards into this big machine. And so my email went out to you, and it went out to the town council. How that happened, I do not know. But she responded back to me, and I could clearly see that I had not made myself clear. So I sent her another email back immediately. I didn't think about it, although I did think I should call my friend Cindy Garfield and run my ideas by her, get all the financials, which I don't understand, and she does. But I decided not to, because she said, It is up to, she didn't have any specifics, it was up to the school board to present a plan within their budget allocation. And I emailed her back and I said, I have already urged the school board to ignore the budget allocation and to do what they think is right and present an adequate budget. So I would urge you again, please present what is good for all of us and the majority. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Sarah Friedman, and I'm the freshman class treasurer. I've lived in Cape all my life, which I guess probably isn't a lot compared to some people. And I really don't know very many of the specifics on the actual budget cut and taxes and everything that's going on with that, so I may not know what's in the best interest of the average adult Cape citizen. But I feel like I really do have a good idea of sort of the student's perspective. And I think that I've been hearing a lot tonight about how what we pride in our Cape schools is that they're a great, it's just good learning and a great positive environment. And I feel like that's really true. I mean, if there are courses, you have to take your recommended courses, but then if there are things you really want to excel in that aren't, you know, normal, like creative writing or anything like that, you know, you can go out and take in it, and they're enjoyable things that you're like. And if you go out for sports and you don't make the varsity team, you've still got JV and freshman teams that will help you get better. And I also feel like there's a really great student-teacher sort of rapport. Like, I really feel like I get along great with all of my teachers. They really help out in anything I need them. Anytime I need help, they do. And I feel like with this cut, I'm not exactly sure if Cape can continue to be such a positive environment. I mean, what will happen if, I guess sports aren't that important, but if like JV teams are cut, you know, where are kids going to get better? Or, I mean, if certain electives are cut, like, then you can only really take, you know, your courses you need to take. That sort of makes everyone the same. It's harder to specialize to do what you want to do. And so I just think that that's sort of generally the opinion of the students, and that really it's not in their best interest.
I'm going to say something really quick. I think everything's been said, so I don't want to repeat anything. And I just want to say that I went to school in Portland and went to a lot of different school systems, and I also went to Waynefleet. And my sample size is 4. I have 4 kids, and their experience is vastly improved upon mine. It's not perfect. We don't have a perfect school system. But one thing that we have that I can see in my conversations with them, I'll illustrate through 2 mini vignettes. My daughter, I have a son who always once in a while throws out the idea of being homeschooled. And I said, what would we miss if we were homeschooled? And my daughter, who's in second grade, said, our teachers. And my ninth grade son, I was commenting on some language in an essay, and he said, my teacher will totally get this. And I think that she's so much cooler than you. But my point is, I've had a very good education. And when I think about what's different about my kids' education, and I didn't, unlike you guys, I grew up in Portland, I didn't want to live in Cape Elizabeth. What's different about them is the ratio, the incredibly high ratio at which they hold their teachers in the highest regard. And I certainly didn't have that experience. And I think part of that, when I think of what it's attributable to, is gotta be the class size. Because, you know, that's just saying the obvious. So that's all. I just wanted to share my personal experience.
Thank you. We're allowed to come up twice. But I know it's a workshop, so it's probably a little more flexible. I am a numbers person. And when I first heard about having problems paying for a $28,000 budget or boiler, I knew we had a big problem. Then when I looked at the fact that we had the cap was almost $600,000 increase, and people say when you have that kind of increase, you know, it's going up, you have more money. When I got the letter that the energy cost, and as we're talking, teachers, the estimate increase in salaries and fringe benefits, with those two costs, we were almost at $900,000, $300,000 over the allocated cap before we started. That said, what a big problem we had. So I just had to bring that up. And Amy, I'll help you with your questions.
Hi, my name is Alyssa Mullen, and I'm on the freshman SAC. I came here with the same idea in mind as everybody else about the education and the teachers. But I also started thinking about sports and extracurricular activities. These activities get kids outside to experience new things. By cutting teachers, you also cut coaches. As we talked about before, the study hall monitors. One of them is Terry Long. He is also a JV lacrosse coach and an alpine ski coach. To cut them, it would not only take away from the education, but the active life of students. I went to the SAC meeting about this, and I heard that JV sports might be eliminated. So that would devastate the reputation and skill of our school sports. We also hear about how Cape. We also always hear about how Cape excels in sports and varsity teams, but it all builds from the junior varsity in eighth grade and middle school. The amount of students that would not have the practice and skill to come straight to varsity would have nothing to do. Coaches are also here to teach students many things that you don't get to learn in classrooms, like teamwork, work ethic, and respect. I feel that this will not only hurt the education in the classrooms, but outside as well.
I'm Heidi McInerney at Bold Fort Road, and I'd like to say with everyone else, I didn't anticipate speaking tonight, but I had to after Amy spoke. I don't know if everyone noticed what she said, and it represents the type of teachers that we have in our school. And she said, if the professional development budget is cut, and I had a student that came in with autism, I would pay $1,000 out of my own account. I put it on my Visa bill, and it would cost me $15,000. God love you. But for her, it wasn't a question of whether or not she would do it, but that she would do it, and she would pay for it out of her own pocket. And that's the kind of commitment we have from our teachers. And I've sat in PCPA meetings and had teachers come and say how much money that they have spent out of their own pocket to educate our children, because we're not providing them with everything they need, with all the supplies, with all the books, and it comes out of their own pocket. And I think it's so sad that, I think it's so lovely that our teachers are willing to do that, but also very sad that we're not providing them with everything that they need. Thank you.
Is there anyone else? Well.
Oh. Sorry, that was my cell phone. Sorry, one more item. My name is David Weatherby, and I live at 14 Stonegate Road. I also happen to be the president of the Education Foundation and a coach in the high school for cross country and outdoor track. And I'd just like to say a couple things. One, I've been here for a while, and I've really enjoyed. I'm sorry, I apologize for this. I've enjoyed listening to what's been said tonight, particularly from the students and the teachers. and the residents. And Sue Pierce has gone through the numbers. It's just 3.4% is unreasonable. It's just unreasonable. Okay? And I think a sense of reasonableness needs to be applied to this process. I think it's our obligation to put forth a budget that maintains excellence within our school system and meets the vision and the mission that we've outlined here. And 3.4% is not going to get it done. And I think what you've seen tonight is a case where that we're ready to defend this as a public group. And I'm asking that you not submit a 3.4% increase to the town council. I'm asking that you submit a number that's reasonable, that maintains excellence within our school system, that makes sure that we're following up on these things that we set forth 5 years ago, and trust that we're going to be here to defend you when the time comes to defend. Thank you.
Members of the school board, I am David Backer. I am a member of the town council. I am the chairman of the town council. I did not plan to speak tonight. I'm probably the only one who has said that who is being honest about it. I came to the school board's budget workshop last Monday, Tuesday, a week ago today, and I came there to listen. I came to the school board workshop on Saturday, and I came to listen. I came tonight because I wanted to listen, and I just want to assure everybody who has spoken that you are being heard.
Anybody else? Okay. Well, thank you everyone for coming tonight and speaking and sharing with us your thoughts and opinions and speaking from your heart. Thank you to the teachers, the students, parents, grandparents, town citizens. Again, I have to say this is quite a contrast to what we experienced last year. So. I'm speaking for myself. I think the process that we're going through around this budget is also going to be very different. At this point in the evening, we're going to go into deliberation mode, and the school board is going to be speaking to each other and asking questions of perhaps of the district leadership team and our superintendent. I think we're just going to have to start and see how we go. In my emails earlier today, I suggested that we start by getting a sense from the board as to where we are in relationship to the 3.4% cap budget, whether we do want to present that for a vote at Tuesday's business meeting. And also get a sense, depending on the answer of that, to the other options before us. Do any of the board members want to discuss this in any matter, or do you want to go right into the straw poll, per se?
Was Alan still going to make a statement, a recap summary that I have?
That'd be a good idea. Sorry, Kathy. Thank
that's
you.
Okay. Just.
Be happy to do that. First of all, I just have to comment briefly, is that it's been very interesting the last 3 days. I've recently, moving here to Cape Elizabeth as a superintendent, I've been reading Bill Jordan's History of Cape Elizabeth. It was published in 1965. And there's a section in there that talks about school leadership. and it talks about the different leaders throughout the centuries who have been here in Cape Elizabeth. And I thought about it and thought, when that history gets updated, probably I'm going to be seen as the new superintendent who caused a hornet's nest around budget the first year he was here. But I hope not, as we go through it. I need to say that the things that keep coming to mind as I listen to you and as I've worked my way through this budget is that, first of all, I need to say that when I was hired as a superintendent here, I came, as you know, from Lincoln County, very, very low-income county. And one of the things that people said to me is, you're going into Cape Elizabeth, there will be no problems with budget. This was as I was riffing 13 teachers last year in my former district. I suddenly found out that there is something about budget here that is very interesting for me. What I have found more than anything else is that what happens is there's been an erosion of budget over the last few years. It has not been really dramatic. It hasn't been something that's made headlines. But suddenly this year, as the new superintendent, I began to realize that I have to come up with some solutions that may not be solutions that everyone will be happy with, whether it be my administrative team, whether it be the teachers, whether it be other people who work in the system, or whether it be the public. But what is very clear on is I had a challenge that I was to come up with a 3.4% budget, because that is what had been set by this community or the town council at that point in time. I also knew that I had to do something different before I even began that, and that was to work with my district leadership team to find out where they were at. Now, I have a principal, Tom Eismeyer, who's been here over 10 years. I have Jeff Shedd, who's been here 6 years, if I'm not mistaken. Five years, okay, he took 1 year away. And I have Steve Conley, who's been here this time for as long as I've been here, but had been here before. And then I talked with the other members of the leadership team and began to develop a budget saying to them, you need to show me what you feel is necessary in order to maintain us as an excelling school system. Not an adequate school system, but one that excels. Because that is the reputation of Cape Elizabeth all over Maine. They were an excelling school system. We have kids who are highly motivated, who want to learn. We have staff that is highly motivated and wants to teach, and that we need to be sure that we're maintaining that reputation and the production of that reputation. So I went out to them, and they began to develop their budgets. In January, as I said the other night, I met with them all, and they went through their budgets. When we were finished, I had a budget that was well over $1 million more than the past budget. I knew I had $596,000 under the 3.4 to work with. But I looked at each of their budgets very carefully and talked to them very carefully about them. And I have to say that every one of them, without fail, had very clear, understandable points on where they wanted to go. And you often hear the stories about the fluff in budgets, the hidden monies in budgets. It just wasn't there. So we started with that budget. So when you look at the budget document and you see a column that says the superintendent's budget, that is that budget. That is the budget which came about with the work that I did with the district leadership team to maintain an excelling school system. At that point, I then had to sit down with the leadership team and say, okay, now we've got this. Now I have to go in with a 3.4 budget. And so then we began to take a look, how are we going to get there? One thing that became very clear to me early on was the fact that there wasn't a lot of places to cut. There had been, over a period of years, the erosion of the budget as time went on. Suddenly I began to see myself and listen to my leadership team talking with me about things that were at the end and not the beginning. Clear examples of that, our classroom furniture. I listened to Ernie speak tonight and know that if you don't maintain the infrastructure of your school system, if you don't maintain your buildings, if you don't maintain the furniture, if you don't maintain the furnaces, etc., you're in real trouble. And so when we stop buying furniture on a regular basis to renew furniture, we're in trouble. Steve the other night brought some pictures of some of the furniture that's at Pond Cove Middle School. I think it's abominable that we have that type of furniture in a school system that is an excelling school system. So with that in mind, I also knew that's all I could work with until I had to start hitting staffing and programs, which I did not want to do. But as we moved ahead, and every time I'd sit there at the table with them, and I'd say, okay, we now have cut $100,000. We only have $500,000 more to cut. And then we cut a little more, and we do a little more, and we do a little more. It was an exercise in futility. I think probably more for the leadership team than for me, because they've been here. And this is a tune they've heard many times over. But the point is, and the point I make very clearly is, I don't feel we have much more space to cut or reduce budget until I truly have to start making inroads in staffing and in programming. Now, the question is, the initial budget, which I presented, which was well over $1 million more than what you had last year, is that absolutely the necessary budget? Is 3.4 absolutely the necessary budget? Or is there a compromise somewhere in there? If I go back to 3.4, I can tell you that as a school system we will survive, but I've heard several of you repeat my words from the other night. Do you want a survival budget? Do you want an adequate school system? Or, if you go to the other end of that scale, you're looking at maintaining an excelling school system. But is there a place in between? One of the things that's in the council's resolution, as I've read it, is that there is room there to begin to talk about extra students who have come into the system. That is something we haven't addressed yet until this year. The finance committee of the board talked about that very clearly the other day. We know clearly that over the last 2 years, we've taken in 38 more students than we had 2 years ago. We know that if we look at that 38 students and we look at our cost per pupil, which is $9,090, that's not including our debt services. If we look at that and we look at those 38 students, that would add well over $300,000 to our budget. If we even looked at the average of 20, that would add $181,000. The council was very clear in their resolution that that is something the school board should come back with. The finance committee has strongly supported that, and I think that's a route we should go. The other piece that we're really struggling with is energy costs. Our energy costs, obviously, like yours at home and everywhere else, are rising quickly. We've been fairly fortunate that this has been a much warmer winter than most of them are. But if we go back over 4 or 5 years and look at our averages, we are looking at probably, if we have a real Maine winter next year, we will probably be $156,000 more than we were this. So energy costs are another major issue for us. So as I think Sue said in my initial letter, when I talked about the fact that we are at 3.4%, we would have $596,000 more. But when I look at that from the perspective of projected increase in energy costs at $156,000, projected increases in salaries and fringe benefits of $716,000, I started out with a 3.4 budget that was already over $300,000 over that limit. So with that in mind, I think there are several routes that the board could go. The board could accept a 3.4 budget. Would we survive with that? Yes. It would be adequate school system, and that's it. And it would take us to a point where when I have to face them next year and talk about the school district and talk about, again, perhaps another 3.4, perhaps a 4, whatever it is, I will then be talking about staffing, and I'll be talking about programs. And again, if you want an excelling school system, you can't do that. Would I like to see the entire 7.8% budget? Oh, of course. What superintendent wouldn't? But can we live with something that comes somewhere in the middle and look at some of the things we need to do and reinstitute some of the things we've talked about cutting? Yes, we could. And part of that is a piece which is part of that initial resolution, is looking at the number of additional students And also, although not a part of the original resolution, is talking with the town council about what we can do about energy costs, because both the town and the school are suffering with that together. And there's one thing that I've become very much aware of as a superintendent. All that money comes out of one pocket. It isn't one pocket for the town and one pocket for the schools. It's all together. So from my perspective is, the board has to make some pretty serious decisions. But they make those based on what they want for a school system, what they want to advocate for this town. The advocacy I've heard from this point on, from emails, from letters, from telephone calls, even people who have been calling me to rework the statistics in 100 different ways, what I've heard constantly is, we don't want an adequate school system. We want an excelling school system. An excelling... And an excelling school system is made up of excelling teachers, excelling students, excelling administrators, who all are working together to keep it where it is. I had a very interesting meeting today. I went and met with the Casco Bay Educational Alliance, which is something I've talked about cutting in the budget, as much as I hate to do it. But it is Falmouth. It is Yarmouth. It is Greeley. And what I found very clearly when I talked to each of those school systems is, what they have done in the last 5 years is ramp up. They have added more. They have had the ability to do that. They're now looking at 3.7, 4.5 budgets, something new to them. But it's 1 year as opposed to 6 years, and that makes all the difference in the world. So as they've ramped up, and we have kind of settled in one place, what has happened is I begin to worry very clearly about what is happening to education here in general and what we need to do in order to be sure we are on the right path. Because I would assume that as parents who pay lots of money for nice homes here in Cape Elizabeth, who pay high taxes, you're here, I've heard many of you say you're here because of the education, and you want to be absolutely sure that you don't get shortchanged on the education of your students. And right now you're not. But I really do not want to be the superintendent who has to make that change. And I know if I last here a few years, I will probably have to do that. So from my perspective is, the board, take a look at 3.4, take a look at 7.8, or take a look at a place in between where hopefully the town council will honor their resolution and take a look at added money because of added population. Those, to me, are some of the choices. You may have others, but those are some of the choices that we have at this point. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. So, are we ready to move forward this evening? Okay. So, I think what I'll begin by doing is perhaps just by hand, saying whether or not you would like to move forward by approving the 3.4% budget. That's how
and then can we have time to just make a comment about where we do stand, or?
Absolutely. If you'd like to make comments beforehand, before the straw vote, that'd be fine too, or after, it's up to you.
I think it would be best if we made our comments beforehand,
okay.
And then if we were to take a straw vote at the end.
Okay.
It would benefit everybody to hear other school board members' opinions, too.
Okay, great. Who'd like to start?
I'll start.
Okay.
Well, you know, everybody appreciates you all being here, and I just have to say thank you, because it is really encouraging to have you all here, and as Debbie Cushing said, I think, it is also really empowering. However, being the optimist that I am, I'm going to believe that you're here to support us and not to make sure that we do the right thing. Because I know that we're going to do our best to do the right thing by our community. I'm not in favor of going with the spending cap budget at all, but I would like to, I just
if you'll indulge me. I know we've been through the statistics and all that stuff, but in my thinking the last week, since we've had our couple of workshops, I went through some of our past budget books and all that stuff, and there are just a couple of things that I'd like to share that some of you have come to that have probably forgotten. But if we look at our per pupil ranking over the past several years, that the Department of Education provides those numbers for, that they used to do that, they don't do it any longer. In 92-93, we ranked 15th out of 117 K through 12 districts. So we were 15th in 92-93. In 02-03, our rank slipped to 52nd. So that's a really significant slip in 10 years. I don't know where we are now because, again, the DOE doesn't provide those numbers. So the obvious question is, of course, where will we be 10 years from now? But I think really the most important question is, how much do we care? And I think that this group is telling us tonight that you all care a lot, and I know that there are a lot of people watching at home, perhaps at home not able to watch, who also care. And I think it's amazing to have, you know, this kind of support. I think one of the most important roles of a school board member is that of an advocate. And I think that this is a time for us to really kick that role into high gear and advocate for what we think is going to enable us to meet that vision of being one of the best school systems in this country. And so having said all of that, I actually am in support of the 7% budget. And there's just one other quick point I want to make. Again, when I looked at the proposed budget last year, there were four things that the proposed budget did not do. And those were increased class size, decreased course offerings, decreased co-curricular, and reduced staff development. This year, we would be faced with doing two of those four. And I think that what we're looking at is a really slippery slope once we go down to that. And there's one last thing I just want to say. And that is that I think that the town council is doing their job. They're trying to do their job, and they're taking into consideration all of the needs of the entire community. But now it's our time to do our job. And that is to advocate for the school district. There are two different governing bodies in this community because we have two different jobs. And so now it's our turn to do what we feel is our job.
I would just like to echo Anne, what Anna said. I've been through six budget seasons with our school board, and what Alan Hawkins has said in regards to the erosion, I've actually worked on, and it's nothing that I took pleasure doing. And there were a lot of different factors that brought us there, and I know that some of us remember 10 years ago when the town of Cape Elizabeth started getting some flat funding numbers from the state because of the school funding formula. And that's when a lot of trimming did happen, and it was a lot of things that people didn't notice that much. It was when, you know, we really went into the budget and probably took a critical look at some of the things that people do characterize as fluff. That took us up to a point until about early 2000 when we had a drastic cut in our school funding. Within the course of 3 years, we lost $750,000 from the state for Cape Elizabeth. And the school board at that time took the task at hand to come up with budgets that wouldn't affect student learning. But again, we had to cut even deeper. Following that $750,000 loss, we started seeing things like the unfunded mandates from the state and from the federal government. We started to lose federal funding for reading recovery. We then had the Pulaski referendum, and people were, again, nervously taking a look at our budgets across the municipal and the schools. Our town council, while admirable for trying to keep our property taxes in check, I can understand what they were thinking. I can't agree with their decision. I really am sad that it takes us getting to this point before we have community coming out to support our schools, but I have to tell you that up until this year, I didn't see that support, and it was very hard for me to get rallied to stand up to speak out for our students. And it made a huge difference. And at this point, I really feel firmly that I could go forward with your help to support a budget that our superintendent stands behind, but will also move our school system forward. I would like to take an opportunity to take a little bit closer look at something around the 7% one more time. And I do not support the 3.4%, and if that comes up as an item on for vote on Tuesday, you know, I would go on record as being against that. But something in between, or I don't want to come up with a percentage figure. I want to take a look at the items that our DLT and Alan have put together as priorities and have that discussion.
Thank you, Lynn.
First, I want to echo everything that was said. Thank you. It's wonderful to have so many people here. I will start off by saying I do not support the 3.4% budget. I have agonized over these numbers. People who know me know that I'm a number cruncher. I have asked so many questions, and I'm one of those people that has asked for the statistics to be done three different ways. So I don't support the cap. I do think it ties our hands. I think town government can make decisions and change them with different information. I think things are different than they were at Pulaski. I also think if you look at the numbers that one avenue to pursue too is that since our state funding is increasing, for the town council to take all of that money and give it into property tax relief and to put a cap on us is double dipping. So I would pursue that also. I think I echo Elaine's. I want to put a budget forward that represents what our schools need. I don't know yet. I guess I would defer to the finance committee and to the superintendent, to the DLT, to really look hard again at what that percentage will be. I know it'll be over 3.4%, and I support that. I don't know that I have a number yet. And there is money in the budget for course reimbursement, Amy, wherever you are.
Thank you, Trish.
I'm not going to add too much because I feel that I'm going to reserve my vote until Tuesday night. I think there's a lot more to be gathered. I think there's a lot of input that we heard tonight. We heard on past Saturday, we heard the Tuesday before, and I don't know about the rest of you, but my computer at home is smoking. I'm getting quite a few emails on an hourly basis. I will say that I would like to encourage the superintendent to look at the student population increase and the dollar figure associated with that student population increase. And also, I would potentially support a number associated with the energy costs. But beyond that, I don't have anything to add at this time.
Thank you, Kathy.
I, too, would like to thank everybody for coming out. Obviously, this is a concern that's touching every single one of us in some way, shape, or form, whether we have children in the system or not. So I would like to thank everybody for coming out and taking their personal time to get involved. I, too, do not support the 3.4. However, I do feel that there is a number somewhere in between there that we do need to look at everything involved here, and we need to look out for what's best for all of our students. I don't have a figure for that. I'm one of those people that's still been asking questions and looking for figures myself. So I would like to defer my final say until the business meeting.
Okay, thank you. Okay, that leaves me. Well, I feel as if this year I've been on a journey not perhaps too different from the town council, where the beginning of this year in January, when I sat at a preliminary budget meeting, we presented numbers, preliminary numbers, that reflected the impact of the 3.4% cap. And I do believe that I said that we weren't going to argue that amount, that we were going to show them what we were not going to be able to do for the schools, but that we understood that there was a cap. Since that night, as a result of numerous finance committee meetings and budget workshops and conversations and emails and input at public forums, I have changed my mind. I do not support the 3.4% cap. I think it would be incredibly harmful to our school district. And I, too, would look back at the budget, see what we think really is necessary to keep our schools moving forward, not slipping backward. And I think at this point what I would like to discuss with the board is how we think it's going to be best to move forward in this process. Do we this evening want to sit down and talk about various parts of the budget, ask questions, and see if we think they should be included or not? Do we want to ask the finance committee to do that work and come back? Do we want to ask the DLT and the superintendent to do that work and come back? I think that probably, we know we don't want to, I think we know we don't want to see a 3.4% budget presented on Tuesday. So do we want any budget to be presented on Tuesday? Do we think we have the time to do that? Do we think the DLT has the time to do that? I throw this out as a possibility. If we were to put on the business agenda the budget recommended in this book, which would be the 3.4% budget, we would have an official vote for or against to bring that budget forward to the town council. Mm-hmm. If it was turned down, we would then have approximately 2 weeks before that budget had to be presented to the town council in written form. We could schedule whatever means for that discussion, whether it be at finance committee meetings or a full workshop on the part of the board, after we got information back again from the DLT and Alan.
Alan has just brought up his calendar.
And I only say that because it feels like 2 weeks to me gives us a little more time than trying to come up with something between this tonight and next Tuesday for a vote.
Mm-hmm. So just to clarify, next week we would vote on the 3.4% budget, yay or nay, assuming it's yay or nay. And then if it's no, then we
We have to go back to the drawing board.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, I think we know, from what people are saying here, it's going to be a no. But I think the question is, where do we go between now and then? I mean, it's a tight time frame. 2 weeks doesn't give very much time. So what's the process going to be? I mean, there are things that can start to happen between now and next Tuesday. But on top of that, what's the process going to be in terms of, because there are very different feelings. Some people haven't said exactly.
Right.
Where's that discussion going to take place?
Yeah. Right. Anybody else? I think we should have the discussion about how we see the process going forward and getting that decided so Alan leaves here tonight with a clear idea of what his time frame is. And I just need to let the board know that I will not be here the last week of March. That, you know, in of itself shouldn't decide one way or the other, but I personally would love to have some sort of a resolution before I leave.
So that would make, I think that would happen because we would need to give that amount of time for
to get it reworked and
get it published. And to get it published.
Because we have to get it published in the board, in the town council's hands by the 31st.
Okay, right.
So some of the options that we have before us, the whole board meet again and just hash out what we think the budget should look like. Give it back to the DLT with some guidelines and have them come back. Give it to the finance committee with some guidelines and have them come back.
What about a combination thereof?
All right.
Well, no, I'm what about the finance committee sort of representing the board and the DLT?
Meeting
and
together.
And that meeting of the minds, so to speak. I mean, then.
I'd be in favor of the full board trying to meet, and because there's some, you know, broad sort of issues before we get, you know, put our pencil to paper here and start.
Mm-hmm. I would prefer to hear from the DLT first before they heard from us. That's part of our role, mm-hmm. Versus us necessarily going down with our individual likes and dislikes.
Well, we have heard, we have two different budgets. We have the budget, the first budget that the DLT was very involved in, mm-hmm. drafting. And so we have their ideas on that. Then we have the spending cap budget. Mm-hmm. And I'm certainly interested to hear what the DLT has to say, but I think they put a lot of work, there has been a lot of work put into it on their behalf. Not on their behalf, on their part.
If I could make a suggestion is, I think obviously you already have a 3.4 budget, as you said. You also have a 7.7% budget. Those two are there. What I would suggest is that you give me an opportunity to go back to the DLT, take a look at the things we have cut, and look at those things as priority and making a priority list. That way, two things happens. Is number one, if we're going to a midway point, I don't know what that midway point is, whether it's 181,000 or 300,000, whatever it is, but if I have those priorities, then I can have better input with you as far as what they would look at as the first priority, the second priority, and so on. And my sense is, I've had some cursory discussions with individual members of the DLT, is I think coming up with that priority list would be possible. I won't say easy, but I'll say possible. And so to have that list and doing that fairly soon would perhaps at least allow that next level of discussion as far as where we're going to go.
Well, if we go that route and have you prioritize everything that's sort of in between the 3.4 and 7.8, then I guess I would like to see basically everything prioritized, because again, there isn't really any consensus here on the board about, you know, I mean, we're not necessarily talking a midpoint. We're not, you know, I mean, there, we haven't really, you know, come to that decision yet. And so I guess, you know, if that's the route we're going to choose, then I'd like to have everything prioritized so that we can really look at, you know, how far do we want to go? I mean, do we want to go for the whole 7.8? And so that we can really see, you know, if we decide to go with the 7%, then what's that going to mean? What are the things that are left out? Because that way, that's what I'd like to see.
And we have a very clear cut list of both current staff, of proposed staff, and also other areas. And so I think, again, we could go to that fairly clear reduction list. I hate to use the word cut, so let's use reduction list, and take a look at those, and therefore then do some prioritizing around them. I think we could do that.
Also, make sure you include things like furniture, books.
Right. No, that's what I meant, is that list as well.
Not just staff.
You have, in your budget, you have three pages. One is current staff, one is proposed staff, and the other one is other areas like furniture, equipment, supplies, and those types of things. So we'd look at all of those.
For myself, I would like not to work off of percentages, but actually to work off of line items.
Yep. Right. That's why if we have everything prioritized, then we can look at the actual.
So, Alan, what time frame?
The people sitting out there, I'm also looking at my own calendar.
I
Let me be in contact with the DLT team, but I'm hoping that we might be able to work out something for Friday morning. I have an all-afternoon Friday meeting with members of some of the Pond Cove staff, but I will try to set up something on Friday morning to do the prioritizing. And I know that they're already prioritizing in their heads right now, so they will come in with all kinds of quick answers for me. So my intent would be to do it. My intent would be to do it Friday morning.
Okay. The earliest you could get that put together for the school board would be?
I am assuming, because we've got the list already, all we've got to do is debate them, discuss them, and put numbers beside them. So conceivably, we could have it done that day. I will have to leave to go to my meeting, as will Tom, but I'm sure Pauline can pull together the last pieces of that to get a document ready to come to you on Friday afternoon. Okay. Right, Pauline?
And I'd like, if everybody could kind of take, do you have calendars with you? We could try to get something on. You don't?
No.
Trish.
Well, yes.
My belief is that we're not going to try to do this before Tuesday's meeting. That probably doesn't make sense, because even if we meet, I mean, unless Monday actually works for us, but we won't meet on Monday just so we can get done by Tuesday.
No, because the budget will be the budget. The budget will be the 3.4% that we're voting on.
That's right. Okay. No.
Why do we have to vote on that at all?
We don't need to.
I mean, it's...
I know.